Thank you, Professor Panda. Today, I'd like to present recent our study to improve the performance of MPI intranode communication. I borrowed this title from Star Wars Episode 4. And if you are a fan of Star Wars and MVAPICH, you should be able to figure out who they are and what they are doing. Anyway, LiMIC is the kernel module that improves the performance of MPI intranode communication by means of kernel support. Initially, LiMIC was suggested in 2005, and from 2009, MVAPICH started supporting LiMIC. However, since then, there were no significant efforts for the further performance improvement. Then recently we made some progress on this. So today I'd like to share our basic idea and preliminary performance numbers. Okay, in this talk, I'm gonna start with a brief introduction of MPI intranode communication. And also I'm gonna briefly introduce LiMIC. Then I will describe our optimization scheme for huge pages. And finally, I will conclude my talk. As you people know, the number of cores installed on a single CPU package is drastically increasing. For example, Night Landing can have 72 cores, and this large number of cores emphasizes the importance of intranode communication. There are several schemes to handle MPI intranode communication. Loopback is the basic one. In this scheme, network interface card and TCP IP provide a loopback path. In the case of high-speed interconnect that support OS bypassing, network interface card moves the data from source buffer to the network interface card by using DMA. And if the destination process is running on the same node, it simply move the data to the destination buffer by using DMA again. So there are two DMAs in this case. In the case of Ethernet, TCP/IP copies the data from source buffer to the TCP/IP internal buffer. And if the destination buffer is again running in the same node, it copies the data from kernel buffer to the receive buffer. So there are two data copies and system calls. To reduce this overhead induced by loopback, shared memory-based scheme has been suggested. In this scheme, MPI processes running on the same node communicate through a user-level shared memory, as shown in this figure. So now we can remove the, we don't need DMAs, and also it doesn't require any system calls. However, still we have two data copies. So to reduce the number of data copies, a memory mapping based scheme has been suggested. And in this scheme, the destination process can map the source buffer to its virtual address space so that it can directly access the source buffer. So now the receiving process can directly copy data from source to the destination buffer, reducing the number of data copies into one. However, this memory mapping overhead is relatively large compared with the overhead of memory copy for small messages. So many of the current MPI implementations use shared memory for small messages, and this memory mapping scheme is used for large messages. And LiMIC is the first implementation of the memory mapping mechanism. So now let me briefly describe about history of LiMIC. We implemented, we suggested the first generation LiMIC in ICPP 2005, which was the standalone kernel module for intranode communication. I said standalone because this first generation LiMIC provides proper inter-process communication by providing send and receive semantics. If you let's take a look at this left side figure. As you can see, this first generation LiMIC provided MPI-like APIs such as LiMIC I send and LiMIC I receive. The The intention of such design was that was to reduce the modifications of to minimize the modifications of MPI implementations when we apply LiMIC. But to do this, we needed to have a message queue inside of the kernel module. This message queue doesn't store the message itself. Instead, it stores metadata of the source buffer, so that receiver can map the source buffer into its virtual address space. However, this internal queue generated several tricky issues. For example, we need to take care of locking for this message queue. And also, we had to take care of tag matching at the kernel level, which is quite a complicated one. And also, we had to consider the garbage collection for abnormally terminated processes. To resolve these problems, we suggested second generation LiMIC called LiMIC 2 in cluster 2007. Now we don't provide message passing semantics, rather we provide memory mapping semantics. So again, let's take a look at this figure. Sender side, the process calls LiMIC TX init to get the metadata of source buffer. Then this metadata is sent to the receiver through the MPI level intra-node communication channel. And receiver calls LiMIC RX comp to perform memory mapping and data copy. So now we don't have in-kernel message queue. So finally, we could improve the latency and bandwidth up to 81% and 358% respectively. And then we released the source code of LiMIC 2 with MVAPICH 2 in 2009. And current version of LiMIC 2 is 0.5.6, and you can enable LiMIC 2 through these instructions. After we released the source code of LiMIC, it inspired several studies, like such as KNAM and CMA, which were also mentioned in the one of the presentation this morning. And compared with LiMIC 2, KNAM addressed a security issue, and CMA is an in-kernel implementation, so this is not a kernel module anymore, and also it provides new system calls. Currently, KNAM is supported by OpenMPI, and CMA is the default intranode communication channel for large messages in MVAPICH 2. Some days back, LiMIC 2 was the default one, but now CMA is the default. However, if we compare the performance, actually these implementations do not much overcome the performance of LiMIC. For example, this slide shows the bandwidth and latency measurement results of LiMIC 2 and CMA on night landing machine. As you can see, LiMIC 2 and CMA show almost the same performance, and if we take a closely look at it, we can see that LiMIC shows a slightly better bandwidth, and latency-wise, sometimes CMA is better, and sometimes LiMIC is better. But the differences are quite small, and this can be very based on the computer, the process architecture. So we had a question whether we have available optimization spaces for better performance of memory mapping. To answer the question, we measure the detailed overhead of memory mapping scheme on receiver side with different combinations of memory type and message size. The black box, the uppermost black box represent the data copy overhead, and below three boxes represent the memory mapping related overheads, which are per page overheads, because these overheads increase in proportion to the number of pages. And we can see that these per page overheads occupy about 40% regardless of what combination you use, which is quite large actually. So we thought it's time to focus on these per page overheads to get better performance. Intuitively, we can think that the easiest way of reducing these overheads is to use large page size, because large page size can reduce the number of pages. So modern processors support large page sizes. For example, Intel 64-bit processor provide 2 MB and 1 gigabyte large pages. So for example, let's assume we have 2 megabyte user buffer backed by normal page of 4 kilobyte. Then we need to run 512 iterations for memory mapping and data copy. But if we use 2 megabyte user buffer backed by large page, only single iteration can we can finish it, the memory mapping and data copy in a single iteration. So in that way, we might be able to reduce the per page overhead significantly. Linux provides two ways of using huge pages. One is persistent huge pages that provide a persistent pool for huge pages that are not split into normal pages. This persistent huge pages is also called huge TLBFS, and you can generate a persistent pool by using this command. And inside of a user program, you can allocate and deallocate this persistent huge page through this library functions. And the other way is to use transparent huge pages, which are transparent to user applications in a location and you use. However, it can be fallen back to normal pages if necessary. This can be done in silently, so we don't know when the transparent huge pages is splitted to normal pages or not. Anyway, we can apply the one of these, and we can reduce the per page overheads. So this is the performance numbers of bandwidth. Left side graph shows the LiMIC 2 numbers, and right side graph shows the CMA numbers. And green line represent the performance with normal page, and orange line represent the bandwidth with huge page. We can see that with huge page, we could improve the bandwidth up to 37% and 35%. But it turned out that the most of benefits came from the least number of TLB misses during the data copy. And surprisingly, the iterations still the same. So no matter what size you use for the page, the iterations, number of iterations are still the same. So we analyzed the current implementation in more detail, and we figured out the reason. The main reason is that the current implementations always assume the normal page size. So whenever it calculates the offset, it simply adds 4 kilobyte, even for the large page sizes. And also, another problem is the gain user pages. This kernel function returns the corresponding page structures for a given virtual address. Linux manages the memory in normal page size unit. So even if we allocate a huge page, which is actually consists of physically linear 512 normal pages. So if we call this gain user pages for this 2 MB buffer, actually this function returns 512 page structures, which means that this function internally run 512 iterations. So that's why we couldn't see the much benefit of huge pages. So to resolve this problem, we modified the LiMIC tool. First, we had to distinguish huge pages from normal pages by using these macro functions. And if we face the huge page, we calculate the offset by using the actual page size. And then also we have changed the way of using GAN user pages. Now we only obtain the first page structure here, and we figured out that this is sufficient to map this whole huge page because these are physically linear and these are mapped to the low memory area of virtual address space, a kernel virtual address space. So we measured the performance of enhanced LiMIC 2 on a night landing machine that had 64 cores, and we used flat mode MCDRAM. And we measured the performance with OSU micro benchmarks, and we slightly modified these micro benchmarks to utilize this MCDRAM. So we allocate the communication buffers to the MCDRAM. So this is slide shows the bandwidth result. In this graph, we compare four cases. Blue line represents the traditional LiMIC 2 with normal page. Orange line is for the traditional LiMIC 2 with huge page. And yellow and gray lines are the enhanced LiMIC 2 with transparent huge page and persistent huge page, respectively. And we can see that LiMIC improved the bandwidth up to 44% compared with this yellow line. And next slide shows the latency result. In the latency perspective, we could improve the 14%, again compared with the orange line. And for all-to-all collective, also we improved the 14% compared with the orange line. Okay. So in conclude, we revealed that the existing implementations for intra-node communication could not fully benefit from huge pages and suggested enhanced memory mapping scheme for huge pages. And we showed that our enhanced LiMIC 2 could improve the bandwidth and latency up to 44% and 40% respectively. For future work, we plan to measure the application level evaluation, and also we are providing patches for LiMIC 2. And quick advertisement, we have a paper in Euro MPI this year. In this paper, we suggested efficient buffer allocation for high bandwidth memory, that's MCDRAM, and also we suggested enhancement for huge pages, which were mostly described in this presentation. And also, we are gonna show the evaluation results for concurrent point-to-point communications. In this presentation, I just showed the single connection results, but if we utilize the MCDRAM, since this is the high bandwidth memory, the benefit of MCDRAM shows especially with concurrent point-to-point communications. So we will show these results also in Euro MPI. So this research was supported by KIST National Supercomputing Center and also MSIP. And though our research lab is very small, especially compared with NOW lab, But not only the kernel level support for MPI, we are carrying out other research directions such as cloud resource management and scalable operating systems. So if you are interested in, please visit our webpage. Thank you.